So this kind of, it's kind of all right for us, but we're figuring it out. Everybody is, you know.
We'll get there. I mean, fuck, this podcast started out of this, and fucking, you know, I've had some awesome friends that agreed to be on it, and now, I mean, fucking Dan from Story of the Year's on my fucking podcast, so I'm sure I'll have Elton John next week at this rate, dude.
I'd get you in touch. He's my gardener.
That's fucking awesome.
COVID's been hell.
Yeah, he's really crazy right now, so.
Well, hey, I wanted to do something. Maybe this would be fun. Maybe it won't. We'll fucking find out. But Wiley originally brought up the idea of having Dan on the show, and I was like, well, fuck yeah. And then Wiley was like, well, let's have a singer on. It's just another singer. So we can have like a singer thing, right? Because we're all singers / frontmen, all that good stuff. So let's do a – there's a little thing on the show I do called the Tournament of Death. And what that is we just kind of pick – some of our favorite things, and we have them all fucking go at it, just fuck until one of them can't fuck anymore, and then, you know, the one that outfucked the other is the winner, obviously. So you guys, there's another thing we brought up on the show, which Dan, you can agree with, ATG, I think you were on this show and we talked about it. There's a definite difference between great singers and great frontmen. Sometimes it can be the same thing, sometimes it can be something separate, you know what I mean? So we're going to have a Tournament of Death. I want you guys to think of some of your favorite singers and some of your favorite frontmen. Okay? And then we're going to have them fuck until they can't fuck anymore. All right? So, Shane, I want to start with you, motherfucker.
Oh, jeez.
Who is, like, your favorite singer of all time, besides me, obviously, and Dan, and Wiley, and ATG?
All right. Well, now we got that cleared up. got those out of the way.
Who else is there? I mean, come
right.
On.
Right.
I mean, I think Jesus sang, but it's kind of flat. You know what I'm saying?
He never nailed it.
No.
Oh my God.
I'll be here all night.
But it's...
I'll start with a fellow named Chris Cornell.
Ooh.
Big fan of his, so there's my vote. Get the party started.
Okay, so straight up just singer, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, he's one of the greatest, most iconic voices of our generation. I mean, like, for rock vocals and stuff.
I agree.
Yeah.
I was working a show, and it was a Carolina Rebellion one year, and I listened to him because they were on main stage, and I was on second stage, so we were tearing down our stage, and I heard him singing over just the night through, you know, the air and everything. And I was like, oh, that's Chris Cornell. And I went to our switching rack and I took a picture of him singing just because it was on our monitors from the other stage. And the next week is when he actually committed suicide. I was like, holy shit, dude. That was fucking insane. So sad. Such a great loss. But yeah, I agree, man. One of the best singers ever, in my opinion.
Side note, did you guys ever listen to Temple of the Dog? I mean,
oh, yeah.
A side project. His fucking singing on that record is so amazing. Like I like Soundgarden as well. You know, I love Soundgarden, but Temple of the Dog is like really, I feel like where his voice shines. It's fucking awesome. Cause it's a little poppier, a little less like fucking weird mathy rock shit that Soundgarden did half the time. But yeah.
But I just went back and revisited that first Audio Slave record.
So good.
It's a great album.
I agree, man. And I mean, as far as I go, when it gets too like I can't really take it. But what his later stuff, he didn't do as much of that, you know, and he kind of just started singing in his own way. Much like, I mean,
even yeah, that cover Nothing Compares to You that he did, from Prince song. And but yeah, it's just like the guy's got incredible pipes.
He's awesome. Dan, who's one of your favorite singers, man?
I don't know. I don't think about this much anymore. It's weird. After being in a band for 20 something years, I'm just like, that's cool. I'm definitely like more in the performance side of things. You know, technically being a good singer is important, obviously. But I always believe that it's more about feeling and vibe and all of that. It's way more important. I mean, like Nirvana was like one of my favorite bands that I learned how to play music from. And Kurt Cobain probably wasn't a great singer, but he fucking nailed it. And he was doing some fucking crazy shit that nobody ever did, you know? And, but I wouldn't say that was my favorite. This is really hard. I don't know. like one of the first shows that I saw that like a singer like really impressed me and I thought was amazing was Deftones, you know, which we could probably all agree on Chino being fucking awesome, both at performing and, you know, vocal ability. But that's like one that stands out. He was always like, I wished I could be as cool as him, you know, one of those things. As like a person I really saw, you know, like Nirvana, you know, I didn't see Nirvana or anything, but there's a bunch of hardcore bands that like ran around and kicked ass and I was like, fuck yeah, but I think Chino would have to be up there.
Yeah, dude, totally. When it, like when I, I've actually said this before, like if I could choose to be like anyone and like have anyone's life, you know, like maybe not personal life, but just like what they do and how they do it, it would be Chino. Because I can go out on stage and like, I'm not going to be him. Like, I love what he does, but I just can't do that because that's just him. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
It's so cool. And yeah, he's one of the, like, I agree, man. There's some people that'll be like, some sound guys be like, man, he's just so fucking off, like the whole show and everything. Okay, well, sure, sometimes. But when it, I mean, you tour for fucking, you know, 90 days in a row and on the 91st day, fucking go on stage and don't sound like a bag of shit. You know what I'm saying? Fuck yeah. You.
So I hit about 40% of notes live all the time, but I'm kicking ass the whole time, so who cares?
Fuck yeah, dude. Yeah, man. I think he's great. So that's a solid choice. And Antonio.
This is tough as hell, man.
That is a hard question.
I wrote the first two I wrote down are mad embarrassing. I'm like
Justin Timberlake.
Justin Timberlake was one.
It's not embarrassing at all.
He's great. He's great.
For the front man. For the front man. I've got it between him and LeJean from Seven Dust.
Oh yeah.
I love LeJean, man.
The only thing is like I'm not that familiar with Seven Dust's with like all their music, but I've like when I seen them live, like I was just completely blown away at like his crowd control and everything and just how intense it was. And then I got to hang out with him for a little bit and just when somebody's like a good, like nice person on top of that, I just, you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah,
I don't know. Cause not all artists are like that. A lot of us are dicks. We know it. As far as voice, vocal, man, just, I have like today, modern, like Sam Smith. If I have to say of like all time, I'm thinking like Whitney Houston before the, before What's Bobby Brown.
Or like during the height of the cocaine when it wasn't affecting her badly yet.
Right.
Kicking ass. Yeah.
How
was she supposed to know?
I gotcha.
How will I know? Get it? Oh, shut up.
That's a solid pick. Wiley, who's your favorite singer, dude?
It's kind of funny. I'm for singers, I'm stuck between three right now, and I'm going to talk myself through this. It's kind of funny. Whitney was also one of the ones that I was thinking. She's one of my favorite singers of all time. Michael Jackson, one of my favorite singers of all time, even though I'm not supposed to anymore. So with the Whitney already being brought up and MJ, you know, being banned, I'm going to go with my other choice, who is, in my opinion, the second best to Chris Cornell in the rock vocal scene, and that is going to be Layne Staley. I think Layne Staley is one of the greatest vocalists of all time. I was never a fan of him being a front man. Like he's a great front man, but I mean, he didn't own it like a lot of people did, like his presence, but he was one of the greatest singers, I think, in rock, hard rock music ever. So I think I'm gonna stick with Layne on this one.
Layne Staley.
Okay.
You have to do Jerry Cantrell too, because their voices together, you know.
Yeah.
Not really
yeah.
What does it, but. And he's still alive, so he's got that going for him.
I was a fucking preacher's kid and fucking basically convinced my mom Creed was a Christian band so I could buy tickets to a concert and go see Creed, you know? And fucking Jerry Cantrell opened up the show and he goes, he like tried to get the crowd into it and he's like, oh, he's like, I forgot, this is the church fucking picnic tour. And I was like, oh my God, he said that.
Awesome.
Yeah. For my top here, I got to go, like, Jeff Buckley's probably my top because, I mean, I named my son after him. And I think that's such, like, sometimes, I'm just gonna be honest, sometimes I think that's, like, a hick thing to do. And I'm sorry, but I just did that anyway because, like, that music just meant so much to me. Jeff Buckley, his voice is great. His story, I think, is great. Just the fact that he was basically busting his ass around New York playing these small cafes, and you can listen to these recordings of him just playing all these songs, and it's fucking incredible. The notes he hits, how he hits them, just the chords that he puts together on guitar. I love the feeling of his music and how, like, a lot of it that came out he hated, but people still liked it. kind of like Silverchair-esque. You know anything about, like, Daniel Johns was kind of mm-hmm. the same story. But yeah, I'm gonna put Jeff Buckley down for mine there.
Hey, can I change one of mine?
Yeah, dude.
I'm gonna do without LeJon and Justin. Put Jack Black for me.
Fuck yeah.
Jack Black? Jack
Black. Whitney Houston and Jack Black.
Jack Black's fucking awesome. I mean, although it's like a joke half the time, but he's a great fucking singer. Mm-hmm. Hey guys, I gotta go to the bar real quick.
You're good, man. okay, that's solid. All right, so now let's talk some frontmen here, okay? Who's some of our favorite frontmen? There's a difference.
Oh, I thought mine was all the same.
Yeah, I was using Jack Black for my frontman.
You know what? We can keep going that route. Let's go your favorites. We'll do that, right? Because if we did 16, it's going to take all night. We'll just do Elite 8, okay? So, who wants to go next? Who's got a pick on the front of their mind here? Because, I mean, Dan, I just want to say before you talk about yourself, probably, Wiley, Dan, I agree with your pick, dude, because Chino would probably be my second. Like, and I already explained why, because if I could be anybody, it'd be that fucking dude.
Figured I might be stealing somebody's vote there, but
yeah.
He knew whose vote he was fucking stealing.
good thing I went second.
Yeah. Well, it's kind of funny. I've probably said this to Dan drunk before, but his stage presence is what inspired me to be a front man, because I was a guitar player before the first time I ever saw a fucking Story of the Year. So, but it would have been Dan, but then this guy came along with the name of Jason Butler and Let Live. Originally, now he's Fever 333. He's without a doubt the greatest front man I've ever seen in my entire life. The way that guy can just...
I got a new one.
Jump off of everything. Go insane, scream, and still hit his fucking notes. He's not perfect, but still screams and hits his notes while flipping off his shit. I saw him jump.
Wiley's dead.
Fucking top of the damn stage setup.
Yeah, he's off.
Saw him jump off the... Can you guys not hear me?
No, God's trying to delete you. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
You're back. It just got still for a second. You're good.
whoops. Jason Butler from Let Live / Fever 33. He's just so insane. I saw the guy literally hang himself at the Firebird with the microphone cable, like, on purpose, and like swing off of it while still had the thing wrapped to where the microphone still lined up with his mouth, so he's still screaming the words to Day 56. It was one of the greatest things I've ever seen in my life. So,
his name is Jeff Butler, you said?
Jason Butler. Sorry,
Jason Butler. I mean, I know the band. I didn't know his name. That's cool. All right.
Fucking awesome.
You're right. Shane, what about you? Give me another one. You gave me one of your favorite singers earlier. Give me, like, a favorite frontman of yours. And don't say Addison Brasher, because that's my pick.
Man, I don't know.
God, take forever. Fuck.
I'll say
have a good one if you need a second.
I'll say Brian Johnson from AC/DC.
Oh, fuck yeah.
Even though, like, a lot of the music does become repetitive and everything, you know, there are things you can say about the band, but you can't help but to get fired up when that guy's talking and singing and those mm-hmm. those, you know, songs kick in and stuff. He's really good at creating that energy.
Has anybody ever seen them live? I've never seen them, but can he, like, just consistently go, bah, bah, bah! like, fucking for an hour and a half? That seems impossible.
Right.
It's got to be, like, just that, right? Like, is his singing voice, like, is it a full voice thing? Or is he just like, bah, 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 bah! Like, Dan was going, like... Because, I mean, anybody could do that real... I mean, not anybody, but, I mean, like, I could do that, but I can't full voice do that. You know what I mean? Like...
I can't do my own voice for an hour, so.
Can't sing my songs for an hour, so.
Whatever he's doing, it works, man.
Dan, you said you had another one, right?
Well, after he said Jason Butler, if that was his name, it made me think about Rage Against the Machine. All my shit's gonna be like fucking date me on how fucking old I am, but
that's fine.
But yeah, Zach from fucking Rage Against the Machine is the most intense fucking badass frontman of all time. So, although Chino is up there as well, but both of mine kind of go hand in hand. But Zach is not a singer necessarily, so he just yells at you and kicks ass. So that's a good pick for that
one. I agree. Do we want to go with eight? Do you guys have a ton more in mind? We could go to 16.
I got two more in mind, but it's your call.
We can fill it. Let's just do it real quick. So who's your two, Wiley?
My two. Did you let off Whitney? Was that Whitney?
We'll be one of yours? We'll keep Whitney up there.
All right. My next one is going to be Dave Grohl.
Ah, fuck. Good one.
I think he is absolutely one of the greatest frontmen out there. And he's also a good singer. If Whitney's already on there, then I'm going to go ahead and bring back my boy MJ. Regardless of what he might have done, he still literally is the reason why a lot of people are musicians. So,
number 23, best singer ever.
Yep. You guys remember Christian from Blindside?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. God.
That's good. I'll put him up there.
Sleepwalking? Oh my god, man.
We didn't put LeJon up here, did we?
No.
I mean, I'm good with him because he's one of my favorite singers. I don't know about you guys.
Awesome. How many do we get each for?
We're just going. We're looking for 16 picks, and then we'll have the battle.
All right. What about Prince?
Yeah, for sure.
Are you going for frontman?
Yep.
Frontman, singer, everything.
I can't remember the name of his band.
Revolution.
Revolution.
We need three more. I want to throw. He does have kind of a rah-rah tendency sometimes, but Miles Kennedy still is one of my favorite singers. He pulled me out of, like, the Scott Stappiness and was like, here, you don't have to sound like Scott Stapp. You can kind of sing, and then kind of I branched out. Then I found Chino. Then I found Maynard's really what changed a lot for me, which I'll throw him up there too. Fucking, because Maynard, dude, like, to me, it gives just the generic white boy stuff to be like, oh, fucking Tool's awesome, right? But at the same time, like, for me, like, growing up, how I did so sheltered, like, just finding somebody, those lyrics where he was just, dude, if you actually listen to what he's saying, he's so fucking smart about what he's saying, and it's so direct and just like, fuck you, and that's so much different than, let's all praise the Lord, yeah, all the time, because Jesus is great. Like, it's just such a fucking difference, you know what I'm saying?
Love that song. Maynard never impressed me, like, he always impressed me. I'm saying that wrong. He didn't impress me on a level that I really felt anything for his vocal stylings until A Perfect Circle. When that first Mare to Gnomes album came out, I was completely blown away. I just felt like maybe it was the fact that he actually tried to write something catchy with the way he writes.
Oh, yeah, I agree.
That just connected with me because I need a hook. I need hooks. Tool doesn't always have hooks.
I agree, dude. Totally agree. A Perfect Circle his work with that band way more. I appreciate. I totally agree with that. Tool, when I was really into Tool, I was really into Tool. And now it's like, I like them and I appreciate them, but I'm not going to sit there for 16 minutes and listen to a song anymore. I'm sorry. Like, you know, to get like two lines of lyrics.
Fans of Tool are kind of make it hard to really love Tool. You know, like people who love Tool, you're like, these people are weird, man.
No, yeah. Those are the people that try to gotcha. They try to put you in gotcha moments. Yo, dude, what's your favorite band? I really like the Deftones. Deftones fucking suck. Tool's the best band ever. What's your problem? Like,
yeah.
Well, okay, champ.
I mean, obviously Tool's fucking great, but yeah. That, I don't listen to him a lot, but yes. Great band.
I mean, I don't know if any band's the greatest band ever because it's such a fucking...
It's all relative to what you like. Who cares?
Yeah. So we need two more. You guys got, cause I'll leave. Well, I'll throw Miles up there.
Well, you said Miles Kennedy and I want to tell you, I saw Miles Kennedy with Slash and he does all those Guns N' Roses songs way better than Axl does. I'm like, it was a ton of fun. But I want to, how about, How about a guy named Chester Bennington? Who, guy like where he could scream and you could, you know, make you feel, and then he could also make it, bring it down and just sing and really make you feel emotion too. So
I agree. That's a really good one. I was thinking of him and Howard Jones. Those are two that I had on my backup, on my reserve here.
Right. We got plenty. So here we're gonna start this shit. Okay.
Cool.
This fucking
should have said John Mayer. Damn.
John, well, hey, I mean, like, it's too late.
Put up a parking lot.
Too late. I'm sorry, sir. So we're gonna decide right now who the best singer/frontman is, according to the Stone Dog Show tonight, because it could change fucking tomorrow and fuck you. All right. Here we go. First matchup we got.
Like Gabe after we do this.
First matchup. I just fucking like just yell at people sometimes on this show. I'm sorry.
Mostly me.
Here we go. We got first matchup, Shane. All right.
Michael Jackson and R. Kelly.
We got Chris Cornell, and he's got a 3-ball mace. Okay. He's fucking coming out into the arena. Okay. And he's fucking getting ready to just fuck shit up. And here comes Jason Butler swinging down from the rafters. And he's got a fucking butterfly knife. Okay? And he's like, you know what I'm saying? Who wins this fight? And it's not really a fight. I mean, it, as
if
far
it's
as singers are front
men. If it's a literal fight, I think Jason Butler would obviously win this one.
Cornell would be like, I'm fucking out.
If they had to have a sing-off, this is a different conversation.
It is. I just got carried away. Sorry.
I bet Jason Butler could fuck up somebody with a butterfly knife.
He probably could.
I wouldn't fight him.
I mean, all right, Shane.
You got to see how literal this is. Come on, guys.
Yeah. Based on
skill set?
Yeah, based on skill set, I'm going Chris Cornell.
All right. Got one vote for Chris Cornell.
Why didn't we nominate Chris Brown from Trapped? We missed an opportunity here, guys.
Because that's your favorite artist.
Man, I did not set up the guitar tonight. I fucked up already.
What's your vote, Wiley?
Cornell.
Okay. Two for Cornell. Dan, you got a vote?
Got to be Cornell, yeah. On singing ability, he's gonna kill it for sure.
Well, that only moves him along. But ATG, who would you vote for there?
Yeah,
same.
Yeah.
Me too. Yeah, it's just unfortunate for Jason. He got thrown up against Chris Cornell. Yep. So, bye bye.
Be hard to beat all around. But yeah.
Yep. All right. Next we got. Oh, this is interesting. Here you go, Shane. Brian Johnson versus Chino.
Ooh,
that's pretty.
That's a good one. That's a good battle.
Depending on when you were born,
all right.
This could go either way.
Are you an 80s or 90s baby?
For sure. I mean, because there's some old heads out there that'd be like, fucking Chino's trash. You fucking kidding me, bruh? You kidding me? You know what I'm saying? I mean, I got to go with, oh, man. Personally, Chino. I got to go Chino. ATG, what do you got?
Chino.
Chino? Dan?
Yeah, I'm going to stick with that. I mean, it's just preference because, you know, AC/DC was a little before all of our times, so I don't think any of us probably like AC/DC more than Deftones, but yeah, it's got to be Chino. He's awesome.
I mean, the first time I heard Thunderstruck was fucking awesome.
It's definitely classic, and it's bigger than what Deftones probably ever has done or will do, but
yeah,
you know, for us, it's a different impact on us. So.
The fucking
That's how 50- I learned to play drinking games, Thunderstruck.
The fucking 500th time I heard it off some douchebag's fucking motorcycle radio, that was like not the coolest thing in the world. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
So, God damn it, Wiley.
All right.
Chino moves on there. All right. Hey, ATG, you know Jeff Buckley, right? You know who that is?
I don't think so.
You know the guy, you know the song Hallelujah? That's what everybody knows him from.
Yeah.
He's not the guy who wrote it, but he did a cover of it. And it's the one everybody knows. Right?
Okay.
So you got Jeff Buckley.
Should have did Keith Buckley from Every Time I Die against Jeff Buckley. That would have
been street fight style.
That would have been fun. Never mind. Sorry. Go on.
Is that the singer?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You say As I Lay Dying or Every Time I Die?
Every time I die.
I was like, because As I Lay Dying would probably just pay someone else to try and kill him.
Yeah. He would win, but yeah.
Sorry, was that?
I've toured with them a lot, both of them a lot, but yeah. I toured with As I Lay Dying right before he went to jail. Technically, we shared a bus.
I have friends. Go ahead.
I was going to say, our buddy Sankus, you know.
Is there?
Whenever Sankus and I meet up, and whenever he's on tour, we meet up, the first thing he says is like, don't be a fucking asshole. No fucking Limp Bizkit comments about this. And I was like, man, calm down. Don't get so pissed you kill yourself. Like, I just keep making death jokes and stuff. And I'm like, yeah, you should hire somebody to do that for you. And he's like, fuck up, man.
You love Tim. All right. He's a good man. I don't know the ins and outs.
But right. Shit happens.
He's a good dude. He's the nicest fucking guy I ever met. I mean, it to make Brian feel or Sankus feel uncomfortable.
Yeah.
If you want to make another joke, don't you, dude? I was trying to clean this up.
See, I mean, if Shane's gonna kill his wife, he's just gonna give her the back half. You know what I'm saying? Like, you don't have to do anything else. Oh, fuck. That's right, folks.
Playing the back nine.
Only here on the Stone Dog Show. Shane's dick jokes. All right, ATG. Jeff Buckley versus Lane Staley. You know Lane Staley, right?
I can't call it.
Because I don't.
Okay. It's all right. I don't blame you. Dan?
I was never a huge Alice in Chains fan, although I was a 90s dude. I loved Nirvana and Pearl. I still love Pearl Jam, although a lot of people make fun of me for loving Pearl Jam. But I would have put Eddie Vedder in there, but too many people have ripped him off and ruined that.
He's
Eddie
playing Vedder. Playing with me. I can't.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I don't know. I mean, as far as like, that's hard. Neither of them are like in my wheelhouse of shit that I listen to much, but Jeff Buckley's probably like classically cooler and I don't know, maybe not. I don't know. Somebody else choose first.
I'm going with Jeff Buckley in here.
Have to.
It's my pick, so
yeah.
Shane, who you got?
I'll go, even though Dan said it too, that, you got to include Jerry in there because of the harmonies and everything, but that Alice in Chains Unplugged set is one of my favorite things ever, so I will say Lane Staley.
Okay. Well, fuck you, Shane. Wiley?
It's Lane.
He's going to go Lane. Shit.
Oh, my God.
Not us.
Lane shit.
Well, I know more Alice in Chains than Jeff Buckley, although okay. I do respect Jeff Buckley, but I'll go Lane Staley. I'm gonna shut you out.
He's kind of like an eclectic kind of a. You gotta fucking know who he is, and then you have to be interested. Like,
yeah,
you have to like that kind of music because a lot of people, some people aren't gonna like it. Like all over fucking some weird acoustic shit. I totally understand.
Yeah, I respect it, but I don't know it well enough to vote for it. So.
We got next matchup here. Here you go. You got Zach from Rage Against the Machine against Jack Black.
Ooh, dang.
ATG, you got a pick here, bud.
Dang,
that's man, hard. That's hard.
The GOAT or
I'm gonna go for who I've seen live, and I gotta go with Jack Black.
Are you Steve DeGluing me right now? Is that what you're doing? I mean, I love Jack Black, but really?
I know.
Dude, I fucking love the microphone.
Because it's off of Frontman, right? I can't really judge off. I've never seen him live. I'm sure if I did, my answer would be different.
I got you.
Jack Black's amazing live. He is. I've seen Tenacious D live. And I have not. I've never seen Rage, actually, but I was supposed to this year, but fucking end of the world happened, so.
Yeah, Rona. Shane, who you got on this?
Fuck you, I won't do what you tell me.
Damn. Aggressive, bro.
Yeah. I'll say right. Zach.
Okay.
Yep, it's me too. It's my pick, so I gotta say that.
So two for Zach?
Although Tenacious D is fucking awesome, but. Yeah. If you would have picked anyone else against him, I would say that. But nope, it's got to be Zach.
Well, to prevent anyone from having to hear Wiley talk, I'm going to go ahead and I'll pick Zach too so we can move on. Jack, I'm sorry, Wiley, I love you.
You know, I don't know why this isn't like all my St. Louis friends' like favorite podcast, like just ever, because it's just making fun of me for 2 hours.
That's yeah, pretty much.
I mean, and Shane.
Shane, no, Shane, don't let him play the victim. He's a fucking dick. Like, seriously, I'll tell the story again. I was like, hey, man, like, when I first started this, I'm like, what can I improve? And he's like, well, you fucking suck, rookie. Like, this all, fuck you, you're a bitch. And that's it. That was his only Facebook reply.
Quit Major League 2 on you, and he told you to get off the tracks when the train's coming through, boy.
He went Ken Griffey Jr. on me, dude. Just fucking. All right, here we go. Christian from Blindside versus Miles Kennedy from Alter Bridge.
Fuck.
God, that's tough for me. Go ahead.
Have you guys seen that movie Rockstar with Miles Kennedy in it?
Fuck yeah.
Like, he's the one in the crowd that goes, stand up and shout, or whatever, and he outsings.
Yeah,
it's fucking awesome. Story of the Year kind of knows him. Him and Slash and all them, they all did the most of their records and most of the Alter Bridge records with Elvis Basquette, who did our third and fourth record.
What? I didn't fucking know that. That's insane,
yeah,
dude.
But, like, we would be in the studio back and forth like weeks between each other, and like, yeah, so little tidbit of info there. But I don't know him well, but like, you know, we've crossed paths a bunch in our time.
That's cool.
So, who else was it? Miles and
Christian from Blindside.
Oh yeah, Christian from Blindside. And he had such a cool, like, weird, iconic voice at the time that nobody was doing that. You know, it's like around like the Refuse time, and
yeah,
where people weren't like fucking doing that gritty, screamy, singy shit that, like, you know, everybody did later, including myself. But, but I think Miles is probably a way better fucking singer.
Yeah.
Yeah. Did you ever get to play a show with Blindside?
I don't think so. No.
They're back together and have a new single, by the way, if you didn't know.
They were over here around like the same time when you guys, when
yeah, it was like 2002-ish. They were like doing a lot. And then right whenever we started touring a lot, I feel like they kind of stopped doing shit for a while. But then I guess like, yeah, I don't know. We might have did festivals with them, but we never met them or anything.
Yeah, sure.
Swedish dude, right?
Yeah. And dude, I'm with you. Like, Miles Kennedy, I fucking worshipped that dude for like ever. Christian is amazing to me because like he didn't originally scream, and maybe, I don't know, Dan, if you're the same, but he taught himself how to and started doing it, and then like was just like started doing this, and that's how they really started hitting it hard. And him as a frontman, I've seen him live a couple times and watched tons of video. That dude is insane. If you ever seen Blindside live, the guy is so fucking incredible. So it's really tough for me. I respect Christian a lot, but for how much I, like I said, used to worship, and I mean, I still really respect him. Miles Kennedy, I got to go Miles on there for me. Who you got, ATG? Do you know these guys we're talking about?
Miles Kennedy. I don't know the other guy, though. So it's kind of unfair.
Sure. It's all right.
Miles's catalog is just, you know, he's proven to be kick-ass, so
he's good.
And he's got to be one of the hardest working frontmen in like the sign. That dude is in everything. He's in every band at some point in time.
Whenever the album that meant a lot to me, just if any, I know you guys don't care, but if anybody does care, fucking Alter Bridge, the second album. The first one was still like kind of Creed-ish, and like, it's not that I didn't like it, but I was very much kind of trying to get out of that, you know, state. But Blackbird, their second album, was where Miles really started bringing his own stuff into the mix, own guitar stuff, and also bringing his own vocals in, like his own lyrics too. And that album just really so much influenced my guitar playing in the beginning. And not that I solo like them, not at all, but like their progressions and how they, like, dynamics and all that stuff. Like, a lot of my earlier bands, I was trying to mimic some of that. But so yeah, Miles moves on because fuck you, Shane. All right. Here's one. This is going to be tough, guys. Prince versus MJ, number 23.
Fuck.
Six-time champ.
Wow, that's a perfect matchup right there. Do whatever. All right. It was my dumb joke. Yeah.
Yep. Can we start with Donald Johnson? Hey, Donald. What's your fucking
name? Yeah. On my iPad, it won't let me change my name. It's very aggravating.
Johnson, Michael Jackson.
Listen, man, this one's fucking hard because, like,
can we call you DJ?
I tried to get that as my name when I, because I lived in this one little town when I was in like third grade and the fourth grade, I moved to this other town, and I was like, dude, it'd be cool, like, I was DJ now, and it didn't stick. Everybody's like, I know a guy that said your name was Wiley. What the fuck are you saying? I'm like, oh, okay, whatever.
DJ Tanner.
This one's very tough because, like, I definitely – either one of those musicians, I would not – there's no way I'd be a musician or a musician had it not be for either one of them. You know, one of the things that I respect a lot about Michael Jackson is the dude literally, like, acapella music that he would tell people to write. Like, that shit was insane to me. It's like, this is the way that I want the song to sound. And I'm like, oh, okay, let me figure that out. And I just thought that was cool as shit. Like, who the fuck, like, a lot of people don't do that. And I just thought, you know, especially when I was learning music, I was like, this is the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. But then you have Prince that can literally pick up any instrument at any time and play it better than you could ever play it. Both incredible singers. Michael Jackson is probably the better singer overall. Like, if you put them both off and said sing off, like, I think Michael Jackson probably have the chops to maybe throw some extra vibratos in there or something like that and leave Prince slightly in the dust. But I think that watching Michael Jackson live would be so mind-blowing. But I think Michael Jackson's my choice. I have to talk myself into these hard ones. I'm sorry. Michael Jackson's my choice.
Got to talk himself to the hard ones. First time we ever heard him say that. All right, Shane. Who you got on this?
34, not 35, not 15.
Well, and also to what Wiley's saying.
You know, don't encourage him, please. Don't.
Michael Jackson is doing all that while dancing all over the stage all night long, too. You know, like one of the best dancers ever. So.
Shimon.
That's choreography, though. Like, there's 20 other people behind him doing the exact same dance.
Yeah, but he wrote a lot of that choreography. Like, he created a lot of that.
Okay, that's true.
Dude, I can't dance like that. You fucking kidding me? I can sing all day, but I can't fucking dance at all. Like,
yeah.
Can't either.
But,
You see me on stage with you, ATG, like, while you're rapping, you see me? I'm just like, okay, okay.
I wouldn't know what to do either. Don't feel bad, game. I'd be like, yeah.
Yeah. No, that's Gorilla J's move. Do that again. Sorry. All right, Shane.
I'm going to go Michael Jackson, man. I saw this DVD of, like, him live in somewhere, I don't know, whatever town it was. And he's watching people, like, in the front row, like, black out and be, like, carted out by the ambulance and stuff. And, like, you know, just, like, it's insane the reaction that people had to watching
that pop star stuff, though.
Yeah.
There's a story here, the creepy crawl. Same shit happened then, yeah, too.
you know, it's kind of crazy, though. They both probably had the best Super Bowl performances of all time.
Yeah.
It's another crazy thing to think about.
Yeah. Some good ones.
It actually started raining during Purple Rain.
God damn.
Yeah, dude, that was insane.
God damn.
God. And then, you know, Michael Jackson, when he did it, when he launched out the scoreboard, like at the LA Coliseum or whatever, he launched out that scoreboard and started off.
He stood there for like a minute and a half or 2 minutes, something like that.
Oh, yeah. He must have built that suspense. Yeah. That's what makes
me. No, he's all like, wait, I have to go 15 minutes? Well, I only have 13 and a half minutes worth of material. What do I do?
So, Shane, you voted MJ?
Yeah.
Wiley, who was your vote?
It's Michael Jackson.
Michael Jackson. Dan, who you got on this, man?
I don't. There's no right or wrong answer because they're both classically amazing. But I'm gonna just go against the grain and I'm gonna say Prince because I feel like he's just a little more badass, just in vibe, you know.
Sure.
And yeah.
That's what it sounds like when doves cry, man.
He deserves the love too. Although obviously Michael Jackson is classically amazing. But well, there's a couple discrepancies with his.
I've seen like there was some clip of like some stupid. I forget who it was, but some pop star was up with him, and it was supposed to be like his time to take over the show. And she was up there just like trying to dance with him, and he like just stops, and he's just like, "Get the fuck off the stage."
Yeah. He's the one, he like fires the one guy on stage while he's singing too.
Yeah.
He's like, "Job gone." That whole... He starts singing "Job Gone." What you gonna do? It's like hilarious, man.
Oh man.
My vote comes strictly from Charlie Murphy's stories on the Dave Chappelle Show.
Oh, yeah.
Anybody for a game of basketball?
Game. Blouses.
Yeah.
Who you got, ATG?
Prince.
Sure. Damn, you guys going to fucking put it on me.
Yep.
Oh, you are. Damn. Oh, damn.
That's the hard one,
oh,
dude.
God, man.
Think about all the times that me and Shane have fucked you over.
Michael Jackson was great, and the bass line to fucking beat it is one of the best fucking things I've ever heard in my life. However, he did touch a lot of kids, and I'm not fucking cool with that. So, yes, he was awesome, but does that put him a rung below Prince, who did nothing but just fuck what he wanted to, and it was consensual?
None of us are cool with it.
The other thing is, MJ didn't write a lot of that music.
Well, what do you mean? He wrote a lot of the Thriller album, right?
He worked with who did he work? What's that guy's name? Oh my God, Barry Gordy? No.
It wasn't not Barry. It was Gordy's label, right? Or
no,
Michael Jordan.
Yeah, I think you're looking. Scottie Pippen, I think, was the.
What is the guy's name?
Production tech. Crazy.
No, I know what you're saying. Yeah, he wrote a lot of that with the dude.
Okay.
Prince might have written with people. I'm sure he worked with everyone. I can't think of the dude's name.
Let's keep it rolling here.
He worked with a lot of people, but he still wrote a majority of the music, especially the early stuff. I think Bad is when he started bringing in most of his producers.
No, he... Oh, my God. Not Thriller.
It wasn't Rick Rubin, right?
First solo... Not Rick Rubin, no. Damn, it's the guy I'm thinking about. He started off working with Ray Charles at first. Then he worked with Frank Sinatra. Had a brain aneurysm and almost died. Worked through that and then worked with Michael Jackson on his first solo album. Like, he co-wrote that with him, and then, like, I think the album or two after that. I can't think of this guy's name. He's still alive today. Like,
are you talking about Quincy Jones?
Quincy Jones.
That's it, dude. Yep. Quincy Jones. Mystery solved.
Quincy Jones is the musical genius behind Michael Jackson, in my opinion.
From like Bad on, not like the early.
But not the Jackson 5 stuff, but his first solo record, he worked with Quincy Jones because they were on the set of that, like the black version of The Wizard of Oz together. And he was like, "Hey, Quincy, I want you to do my first album with
The
me.
Wiz?
The Wiz. Man, thank you. You're like Google right now."
He's a pop.
I know a lot of very unimportant shit.
All right. Next matchup, Maynard versus Chester Bennington. I got to go. I mean, goddamn, I'm not going to vote on this one. ATG.
Chester.
Yeah.
Wiley.
Chester.
Shane.
Chester.
I mean, Chester's amazing. Dan, I assume Chester.
Chester, yeah.
Gotcha.
I'm a little biased, you know. We toured together and.
What?
We were friends. Oh, yeah. Story of the Year did a couple months with them in 2004.
Huh. That's fucking awesome, dude.
It was the biggest tour we ever did, still have ever done. Other than when we toured with Deftones, which was equally as big. Not trying to be a name dropper. I'm cool, but those are the two biggest tours we ever did. But yeah.
Cool, man.
Linkin Park took us on tour when we were, like, before Until the Day I Die had hit radio at all, which is partially the success of Until the Day I Die was because we were on that tour, and it started getting picked up by everybody, and it was insane. And then Johan... the DJ did he directed our second video for Anthem Over Dying Day, so good times. So obviously it's Chester for me.
Did you ever get to hang out with the guys? I mean, because like sometimes like Cabo, yeah. I'm friends with those guys, and like I know they were on tour and they would get to hang out with, you know, different people different times.
Yeah, we hung out a lot. Like the very first day of the tour, they all came into our dressing room, like separately. Like they were like, "Hey, let us know if you guys need anything. If anybody's being an asshole, just come straight to us." And they were like the coolest fucking dudes ever. Chester owned a tattoo shop at the time. He flew his tattoo artist out. I got like 3 different tattoos on that tour and shit.
That's so cool.
They were fucking awesome, man. They all had their own separate bodyguards, which was fucking crazy because we were like 22-year-old kids and we're like, "You have bodyguards? Like, what the fuck is going on?" But they would always, it was fucking awesome. Crazy tour.
That is cool.
16 years ago.
Well, Chester moves on. Shane's bodyguard is his dick. That's all he needs. Say no. Don't come running at him because he'll
firm.
You'll get
very
stopped.
Firm.
6 feet distance, trust me. Whether you like it or not.
All right. Yep. That's why he was so pissed off whenever the school or like when his job was like, "Dude, you can't be at work." He's like, "Dude, I know for a fact there was 6 foot distance."
All right. Dave Grohl versus Whitney Houston.
Oh, fuck.
Yep.
Oh, that one hurts.
It.
That one hurt.
I dropped
me.
It. I dropped
that
it.
That one hurt me. Oh.
Singer or performance?
This is just straight up, dude. Who you got?
Overall.
Man?
Who wins overall? Fuck, man. Dave Grohl, 3.5 hour long sets, fucking running up and down the ramp. I don't think Whitney could have done it running.
I think in the long run, Dave.
Yeah.
Dave also didn't write like falsettos that went fucking 17 fucking.
She was so hot too.
Dave will never.
Back in the day, God, she was so beautiful, man.
Yeah.
Dave will never outsing her. Obviously, that's not even a question. But
Screamer though.
I would go with Dave Grohl just because, like I said, Nirvana was my favorite band ever back in the day. So.
And Dave never sang any like national anthems really, really badly. Okay.
Dave's a beautiful man as well. So,
yeah. So what was your vote, Dan? Did you say one way or the other?
I'm Dave Grohl. Yeah.
Dave Grohl. Wiley?
How will I know? No, I'm going to go with Dave. That's a tough one.
Wow. Nice fake out. You got me. Hey, TG.
Wiley, didn't you cover that? Didn't you cover
Whitney? I want to. So- no, I did. I did.
You did acoustic.
No, I covered. No, I didn't. It wasn't Whitney, but it was Mariah.
Sorry.
Yeah, man.
But I'm gonna now.
I'll probably go with the writer. I don't think Whitney Houston really wrote anything for real. She was just such an amazing singer and performer. I'll go with Dave.
Okay.
That's a good reason. That's good reasoning right there. I like that.
Well, Whitney loses then, but Shane, do you have a vote?
I would also say Dave Grohl.
Dave Grohl. Okay.
I think I would more enjoy Dave Foo Fighters concert than
All right.
After 5 Whitney songs, I'd be done, but after like 30 Foo Fighters songs, I'm still like, can I have some more?
We're getting deep in the tournament here, okay? First,
I'm getting deep.
First matchup of the second round, Chris Cornell versus fucking Miles goddamn Kennedy. Shane, who the fuck you got in this fight? Shane.
I'm going to stick with Cornell.
Cornell. ATG?
Chris.
Damn. Dan?
Yep. It's got to be Chris Cornell. I mean, yeah.
Yeah. Miles Davis might be one of the – or Miles Davis. Miles Kennedy
Davis?
Might –
Hello.
Miles Kennedy might be one of the few singers that could actually hold a candle to.
Yeah. I bet Miles would vote for Chris Cornell.
Yeah, probably so.
Yeah.
You're right.
Yeah. Cornell wins this, but I think that if you were actually going to compare like active singers in the last 10 years,
it'd be Shane Presley.
At least in rock. Yeah. At least in rock. Those two would have to be two of the biggest names you say because he's fucking incredible. I used to think he was just a Scott Stapp wannabe until I dug deep and I was like, oh my God, this guy is fucking incredible. So, but yeah, we know where this falls.
We do. All right. Prince versus Jeff Buckley. I feel like this is. I feel like you guys are all going to vote for Prince. Who's not going to vote for Prince? Raise your hand.
I thought we voted Jeff out in the first round.
No, we didn't.
Oh.
Sorry, you suck, Shane. Pay attention. Fuck you.
Well, we'll vote him out this round then.
I think Prince has
to. We'll vote him out this round.
Either way, you lose.
Shane's like, I'm paying attention. Did I fuck you over yet? No? Okay, well, go fuck yourself. Yeah. All right. Prince, I assume. Wiley, yeah?
Yeah.
Dan?
Yep.
Okay. Prince moves on. Next matchup on the other side of the tournament bracket here. Look at this. My mom bought me this notebook for Christmas. I didn't know what the hell I was going to use it for.
That's how I always feel when I get a notebook. I'm like, what the fuck?
She's like, here, have some socks and a notebook. I'm like, and then one day I'm like, I need a notebook. God damn it. I fucking have a fucking notebook. All right.
How did she know?
All right. Zach from Rage versus Chester fucking Bennington. Oh. Dan, I'll let you go first, dude.
Oh, man, that sucks.
My feelings.
Oh, come on. Okay, well, all around vocalist, singer, Chester's more of a singer. Fucking great singer. I watched him literally every day for 2 months, and I don't think he ever hit a bad note. Like, it made me mad, and it made our whole band better at what we do. But
that's awesome.
Rage is, like, classically a way bigger inspiration on my life. I wasn't even a Linkin Park fan until we did that tour. Me and Ryan actually said no. We're like, nah, don't want to do it. We were trying to turn down 15,000 people every day for some fucking dumb reason, and then we did it, and I was like, whoa, that would have been fucking terrible if we didn't do it. So totally humbled me and made me realize I'm an idiot. I'll go Chester. It's got to be.
Okay. Wiley?
It's really hard, man. I'm having a tough time with this one because, like, the lyrical content that Rage Against the Machine has, that Zach has, is some of the most profound and amazing stuff that's happened in my lifetime from a vocalist, the things that he stood against and made people aware of just through catchy music. There wasn't a lot of bands that were as obviously outward with their message, and that was just a whole new thing. I mean, there's the punk rock scene, but that wasn't as radio and commercial, right?
I would like to say there would probably be no Linkin Park without Rage Against the Machine.
Yeah,
because they were doing the rap rock thing, you know, first, like, on that level. So there would be no Linkin Park. But sorry,
I can see that.
I also don't know how I would have gotten through my fucking freshman year of high school without Hybrid Theory. Like, I'm torn. I'm so fucking torn right here, and I don't know how to. I don't know how to answer this one. Somebody else go. Come back to me. Come back to me.
Sorry, Shano, who you got?
I'll say Chester.
Oh,
it's tough. Tough call, but yeah.
Antonio.
It's tough, but I'm going to go Chester too.
All right.
I'm kind of surprised that I even went Chester, but you know.
Well, I'm just glad I don't have to vote because.
Like, I think Shane said earlier, or somebody said, after when you meet people and they're cool and, like, you know, they have more of a personal impact on you in that way. So that's the only reason that edged it out, really. But
for sure, man.
That song, By Myself, off of that Hybrid Theory album, In a Place for My Head, those two songs. I don't know, man. That shit kind of got me through that and the Papa Roach and Fest album, between Angels and Insects, and like those it's like four songs.
You did this in high school.
Dude, I wore large t-shirts and black fingernails and ball chain necklaces with very baggy pants. That was me.
Yeah, you did.
All right. Dave Grohl versus Chino. Wiley, you're up first.
Fuck you! Jesus!
I didn't think about
Chino, obviously, but fuck you, man!
I didn't think about how hard this was going to get as it went on.
Oh, God!
That's the fun. That's the fun. Dave Grohl versus Chino. Come on, bitch! What you got?
Oh, bitch.
No. Fucking Chino.
Chino.
I'm glad I can see both your hands because I was like, I was like,
I'm so glad I didn't offer up Dustin Kendrew and you fucked me on both of them.
HG, hey, you got it. You got to vote while he's fucking having a panic attack down there.
Dave, bro.
Shano.
Dave Grohl.
I knew you were gonna say that. Fuck. I'm going Chino.
Fuck. That was Chino as well.
Listen, I love Dave Grohl. Don't get me wrong, but like, and me too. Listen, but it took
Dave
me.
Grohl's my hero.
My friend took me to a Foo Fighters concert because I didn't really care for him that much, and it's when the Pretender came out and that tour or whatever, and we sat in the fucking top of the fucking wherever, whatever arena we were in, like nosebleed seats, and I watched this band, and it was like, holy fucking shit, this band is awesome. And so it's like, for me, like, he's kind of wanted, like, he writes songs, kind of like my own songs, honestly, like a couple, after I listened to like four or five of them, like, okay, I get this, you know what I mean? Like, that whole kind of style, like, it just wears on me after a little bit.
He knows how to write songs. You don't need hooks he doesn't even need vocal hooks for you to be caught on to what's going on drum and guitar wise. It's so cool how that works.
But Dave, I mean, Chino, dude, the albums, it's not that Foo Fighters don't have different sounding albums, but the Deftones have different fucking sounding albums, bro. Like, there's something for almost every mood I could possibly be in. I fucking love that shit. So I gotta go with I gotta go Chino.
I got Chino as well.
Dano, you got a voto? Yeah. We'll make Wiley decide.
Because Dave Grohl, well, Nirvana was a bigger influence on me first, but then Deftones was shortly after, you know, like only a few years. It was like 95 or whatever. I guess Nirvana was like 91 or 92. The first time I saw Deftones was at the Galaxy here in St. Louis.
What?
Yeah, in 96.
Wasn't that Deftones angle? Oh, no, that was the different show. Never mind.
I watched that show on YouTube, like on a fucking amazing VHS.
There was a Deftones and Glassjaw show there, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, that was after that. But guess who opened? This is the Galaxy. It holds like 300 people or whatever, 400. Limp Bizkit was the opener.
Yeah, I remember that.
But the best part about it is me and Ryan and a couple other people, like a couple of the story of your guys, we all showed, this is a long story to get to this end of the story, but it's a fun story. We showed up. And it was sold out, and we didn't have tickets. So we're like, we showed up early and shit. We were like little punk-ass 15-year-old kids, you know? And we were just hanging around, and Chino came outside. And we're like, yeah, dude, you're fucking awesome. We were just talking to him for a minute, and we're like, well, this show's sold out. We can't get in. And he's like, oh, that's cool, dude. I'll put you guys on the guest list. How many you guys need? He fucking put us on the guest list as like little fucking nerdy kids because the show was sold out. And it was like, you know, one of the best shows ever of all time. And then we told him that story, you know, in 2006 when we did Taste of Chaos with him. And he's just like, yeah, that's cool, man. He's like, yeah, whatever. Yeah, of course I did that 10 years ago. So in that case, since as I was going on personal relationships, he's fucking awesome. And I'm going to have to go with Chino.
That is fucking awesome.
That one hurts. That one's hard.
Do you guys know who Sonny Mayo is, right?
Yeah. Former guitar player of Snot and Seven Dust.
So it was nothing as cool as that story, but this is a story of a time that I was hanging out the side of my friend's car drunk, and we drove by the venue because we were going to see Seven Dust, and Sonny, it was when the next tour when Sonny was playing with him, he's outside the venue, and I was like, hey, because I like just realized who it was, and he's like, what's up? And I'm like, you're Sonny Mayo, and he's like, fuck yeah. Yeah, I always remember that. Anyway,
remember that time that I had to have you come on stage and sing part of the Pretender with me because there's no fucking way I could have hit the vocal part when he's going on and on. Or wait, no, that wasn't the Pretender, was it?
It was.
What song did you sing with us? Was it the Pretender? Yeah.
I think it was the Pretender.
Yeah. What if I say I'm not like you? Yeah, that part I had to have you do whenever we did the Foo the City night. You guys did Nine Inch Nails. That was a good fucking night, man. Foo the City. And you had to do the Pretender because I can't sing that song.
So would you, Wiley, who would you vote for in this?
Chino. Yeah, it's Chino.
Just making sure. All right.
All right. Fuck you, Dave Grohl.
No, not fuck you, Dave.
Enough. You've had enough in your life. Today you
I'm so sorry, Dave.
All right, here we go.
If that ever gets out to him, I'm sorry. I'm just kidding.
This is the fucking semifinal matchup here, okay? Chris Cornell against Prince.
That's funny because, as Shane alluded to earlier, the Nothing Compares to You cover, like, Prince and him both having done that.
This is gripping podcast fucking entertainment.
I'm just mad
right
at
now.
I'm just mad at who you keep pairing up to each other. You're putting two iconics together too early.
Well, Shane always pisses me off, so this is me pissing you off, okay? So who you got in this, ATG? You going Prince or you going Chris Cornell?
That's tough.
You're right, it is.
Man.
Look at the wall for a minute. I know, man. Clarify.
Give me Prince.
Damn, drop the mic. One for Prince. Shane, who you got in this, buddy?
No, this is one of those coin flip ones, just like that last one. It could very well change tomorrow, but being that I, again, just listened to the Audio Slave record, I'm going to say Cornell.
Damn. It's getting fucking hot and sweaty and sexy up in here. Dan, who you got in this?
Weirdly enough, I never have listened, other than the singles that Audio Slave put out, I've never heard Audio Slave in my life. Although I was a huge Rage Against the Machine fan and a pretty huge Soundgarden fan. But at that point, I was kind of over it. But I, you know, I like Prince and all, but Chris Cornell had a way bigger influence on me vocally and musically. So it's got to be him. I mean, you know, I know that Prince is more badass all around in life, technically, but. You know, Chris Cornell was bigger as an influence for me, so it's got to be that.
Okay. Wiley?
Cornell had a 4-octave fucking range. I think, didn't Prince have, like, one better or some shit? I don't know.
I like making you decide because you're, like, literally sweating. Like, you're going to have to change your drawers after this shit, dude.
I care about music. This one, I care more about this one that you did tonight than anyone you've ever done. Like,
I know you've, like, adjusted your hat like 16 times.
Restaurant mascots and fucking action stars. I'm like, fucking beer, whatever. But this one bothers me. It matters at the end, like, right? Like, what? But,
Yeah, it matters the fucking Stone Dog Show. Number one show in fucking St. Louis, goddammit. Soon the fucking country. And then another country. I haven't decided which one yet. Might be Mexico, might be Canada.
So you're number one over Rock Paper Podcast?
We're right there together. We bring each other up. That's what we do.
I'm going to go Cornell.
Cornell?
Does anybody listen to that Unplugged record he did in Sweden?
I don't think I have.
It's incredible, man. That's what sold me. Obviously I like it all, but... That, like, him and his vocals and a guitar, and, like, it's pretty incredible.
Here you go, Shane. Chester Bennington from Linkin Park versus Chino. Because it could be Chester from down the street from you. I'm talking Chester Bennington.
Chester the molester.
Chester's chicken.
Not Chester that has, like, a Ferrari that hasn't worked since, like, 1986. You know what I'm saying?
I gotta go Chester Bennington. He's a lot more part of my life.
Okay. I'm going Chester on this one too. ATG?
Chester, for sure.
That's three. Now, it's again.
31. We don't have to vote. I would have said Chino only because, like all the other shit, they wouldn't, Linkin Park also wouldn't have existed without Deftones. But they were both bands that I toured with, and I love both of them dearly. So.
It took me.
Chino was, you know, first in my mind. So
it took me a little bit to come around to Chino. Like, Linkin Park was somebody I listened to early on, and I just, like, really latched on to that. Yeah. And I originally was like, this is Deftones. Cause again, I was like very sheltered growing up. So I was like, Deftones, this is too heavy. This is scary. You know what I mean?
I think I might be the oldest one here. I'm 39. I'm almost 40. And you know, Deftones was like prime. I was like 15 and I was like, fuck yes, this is fucking awesome. Yeah. And I didn't like most of that shit. I was into like faster punk rock shit for the most part at that point, like NOFX and Bad Religion, as you see back here. And I definitely was not into like the Christian side of music, you know? So Deftones was like, fuck yeah, this bridges the gap of punk rock and like new metal and the way that that world was working in the mid-90s, which later is what Linkin Park was doing too. But you know, at that point I was a little older and it wasn't the same, but
yeah. I think like you're saying though, it's like that stuff hits you at a certain point that you hit it at the right time. And I didn't think a lot of us that, you know, like Wiley was talking about freshman year and stuff, like when that, you know, we're all mid-30s there and hit that Linkin Park record, Hybrid Theory drops, and you're like, totally changed everything for us in high school.
Well, but at the same time, White Pony hit around the same time, and that was also one of the most influential albums in rock music ever. So
all good, yeah.
My gateway to that music really was POD, because when Fundamental Elements of Southtown came out, you guys know that album? You guys ever listen to POD?
Very well.
I
can keep my story going, because guess who else was on that Linkin Park tour that I did?
No way.
POD. Yeah.
That's so cool, man.
It was Linkin Park, POD, and Hoobastank, and we were opening. So quite the fucking tour.
Yeah. It was insane. Hoobastank made some – they made one album in particular, the one that had The Reason on it, I really fucking liked.
That album was great. It had just come out when we started that tour, and The Reason wasn't out yet. And by the end of the tour, like 2 months later, that was like the number one single on fucking top 40 radio. So they blew up in the middle of that tour, and it was fucking insane.
Jeez, man. Yeah. Good Lord, that's fucking awesome.
But I respect the Chester moving on, because I'm fine with that. But, you know, Chino would have to be my vote. But music connection is all about timing in your life, like all of it. It doesn't, there's no right and wrong. You can't say like, well, you're stupid because you're younger than me. You don't get it, you know? It's just about how it connects with you at that time in your life. That's how music is.
It's so true, dude. There's a podcast that I don't listen to all the time, but it's the Dave Glover Show, because when I was growing up, it was like on a conservative radio station that my brother and my parents would turn off when his show came on because they said he was too liberal. So it was somebody that I started listening to, and if you listen to his show, like he's in his 50s, but he has people in his show that are like in their 20s and stuff like that. And it's just a mix. And when they do this kind of like stuff, if they put bands up against each other, whatever they're talking about, it's always like, it's always fucking Kiss and fucking the Beatles and, you know, the Who and all this stuff. And it's like, yeah, like you're saying, Dan, it's not that those bands aren't great. It's just that we missed out on that. Yeah.
Yep. It's like earlier when AC/DC was in the mix. It's like, obviously a great band, but they didn't connect with us, probably any of us, on the same level as all these bands we're talking about now. So
sure.
Doesn't make anybody better or worse. It's just how it connects to you.
Sure. It just makes me better than Shane. Next up, Chris Cornell versus Chester Bennington. Here we go.
Ooh, wow. What a fucking turn of events.
I knew that's what it was going
to be. That just got controversial.
Wiley's ass just puckered so hard.
I'm talking about the whole conspiracy theory about the two of them.
There's a lot of that shit going around.
Me and Shane?
Yes.
Oh, sorry. Chris Cornell and Chester. Gotcha. Yeah, you're right. I mean, like, dude, who knows? Who fucking knows? I don't know. So, I don't know. I just don't know. But, out of this group, I gotta go, man. Oh, people are gonna fucking think I'm crazy because, like we were just talking about, I'm sure Chris Cornell meant maybe even more to people because I feel like radio was such, like, when Linkin Park hit, radio was still a thing, but, like, when Soundgarden was around, radio was really still a fucking thing. And I feel like maybe more people might have been influenced by Chris Cornell, but Chester Bennington influenced me more. So I got to go with Chester.
Same. I got the same vote.
Same.
Come on, Dan.
Chester.
Yeah.
Jameson shots.
Before we get there.
Much respect.
I think I agree that Linkin Park was more of more socially Influential.
Influential.
They were more, it was more of a lifestyle thing with them, you know? I mean, Soundgarden was like just technicality and fucking badassery, and the way he fucking sang was amazing. But Linkin Park connected with people on a different level, and they still do, you know? So, yeah, I'll go with Chester too.
Fuck.
Yeah, I mean, because, okay, so take this. I sang along to The Day I Tried to Live one time, and I got it right. I nailed it one time. However, let me tell you something. If I had to do that like 12 times in a set with songs like that, there's no fucking way in hell.
Yeah.
That dude was insane. You can fake it for a song. You can do it for a little bit, but that dude did it for years. He was fucking insane.
There's that song, that Audioslave song, What You Are, where he kind of fucking went stupid crazy high as well. I don't know if you guys remember that song, but it's unbelievable. I don't know how you guys are not voting for Cornell here, but it's fine. You can be stupid.
Thank you, Spaceman. Fucking appreciate it.
I think Chris Cornell is probably a better musician, probably a better singer, but the connection was different with Linkin Park, like I said.
So we got... do we have three for Chester?
You know what? Yeah. You know what, guys? Hang on. You know what? In the end, it doesn't even matter.
Oh, my God. Well, okay. So to be formal about it.
Nailed it.
The winner of this Tournament of Death, this was a long one, but it was a good one. We got Chester Bennington coming out on top, just like Shane does, and walking away and never taking responsibility. You know what I'm saying? Chester Bennington wins the Tournament of Death on episode 19.
Damn,
it's been a fucking lot of episodes.
I didn't see that one coming.
Didn't even see it.
Did she? Right, Shane?